scars the trail, cursing the quest, caught in disaster, measureless nights forebode, moments of rest, glimpses of laughter, I treasured along the road. Along the road, your steps may stumble, your thoughts may start to stray. But through it all, a heart held humble, levels and lights your way.
Good morning. Welcome to worship with the community of the First Unitarian Church of Omaha. I'm the Reverend Shari Woodbury, the church's settled minister. Whether you're attending online or in person, I'm glad you have chosen to join us on this beautiful, crisp fall morning. We're here for worship, which from the Latin means to remember that which is of worth, to call us back to our highest values. A special welcome to visitors this morning. This congregation is a community of all ages and abilities. It is a community with a rainbow of gender and sexual identities. It is a community of diverse cultural and class backgrounds. We draw from many sources of inspiration and share common liberal religious values. Whoever you are, we welcome you to bring your whole self into this community. If you are joining us online and haven't done so already, I encourage you to create a YouTube account and sign into it when you attend online, and that will allow you to make comments, to share a joy or concern, to shout out your appreciation for wonderful music if you're so moved, or chat with others who are watching online. Those in the sanctuary are invited after the service to go downstairs to the common room in the basement for coffee or tea and conversation. You can sip and visit there. You can also take a to-go cup and go visit in the garden if you'd rather be in the fresh air. However you are attending, I encourage you to check out upcoming events around the church. I'll mention just two today. On September 25th, we have a special congregational meeting that the Board of Trustees has called. This is to start a process that, as described in our bylaws, would allow the congregation to take a public stand on a social justice issue, in this case, reproductive justice, including abortion access here in Nebraska. So that will start with a special congregational meeting on September 25th. You can attend in person or online right after worship that day. And I also want to mention that we have a new small group ministry program starting up called Chalice Circles, a wonderful way to connect with others and explore topics. The commitment right now is only six times between now and mid-December, so it's a great way to build some relationships. And Mike McAtee and Neva Cousine will be there to answer questions or even sign you up if you're ready at a table back in the foyer after the service. Each week, we acknowledge that where we meet for worship as the First Unitarian Church of Omaha is the land of the Omaha Oto Nations, and that Indigenous people in the greater community have become marginalized and made invisible. We recognize their presence among us and aspire to work with them to resolve issues like poverty, displaced children, and murdered and missing Indigenous women, the MMIW. And speaking of Mike McAtee, this morning I invite him to come forward and light our flaming chalice. If you know Mike, you know he's been one of our champions for some years for small group ministry, so this is a nod to his leadership with that. And I invite you all, as he lights it, to join me in the chalice lighting words. You can echo each line after me. Spark of the Spirit, cupped in Earth's embrace, light of love, alive in all creation, as we kindle this flame, we rekindle our connection to the sacred web of life. Thanks, Mike. We have a responsive call to worship this morning, which comes from Tess Baumberger, and is titled, It Takes a Unitarian Universalist Village to Raise a Child. We'll read what we believe is important for our children to learn, to know, and to experience, and we invite you all to respond by saying this line, It Takes a Village to Raise a Child. And I'll cue you like this when it's time. So shall we try that? We'll just practice it once. You ready? It takes a village to raise a child. One more time. It takes a village to raise a child. Okay, we got it. Let's go.
It is important for our children to know that they are cared for, to know that they are part of a larger family, an important part of a bigger human picture.
It takes a village to raise a child.
It is important for our children to believe in themselves, to trust in themselves, to know that they can make a difference.
It takes a village to raise a child. It is important for our children to know our Unitarian Universalist principles, to find ways to live them in our daily lives, and to realize that the choices they make are important.
It takes a village to raise a child.
It is important for our children to be able to speak about our faith, to honor its history and its heritage, and to appreciate its heroes and heroines.
It takes a village to raise a child.
It is important for our children to explore religious truth and meaning in the Jewish, Christian, and other world religions, and to know that ours is a religion worth having.
It takes a village to raise a child.
It is important for our children to experience the spirit of life, to feel a sense of awe at the grandeur of the world, and to live lives of empathy and compassion.
It takes a village to raise a child.
Our opening hymn is number 1008, When Our Heart Is in a Holy Place. Note that while masks are not required in the sanctuary at this time, we do ask you to wear a good mask if you'd like to sing, since it's a higher risk activity. And there's extra masks at both doors. It's also fine to just listen. You can stand if you like while we're singing, or remain seated if that's better for your body. 1008, When Our Heart Is in a Holy Place. That's in the teal hymnal.
The wisdom of the world.
I'd like to invite Terry Lynn Brewer and Amanda Burton and all of our children, our young and young at heart, to come forward for our story for all ages.
And all you guys, how you doing? Have you guys heard of garbage and, you know what garbage is, right? Oh, you know what garbage is?
Help the earth.
Yeah, help the earth, yeah. We're gonna help the earth today. We're gonna read a story about climate change. And Amanda's gonna read it, and I'm gonna try to do the sound effects. And if you guys wanna, maybe we,
I have something to tell you guys. All the pigs are standing, guess what? This is the thermometer, and like this is the grave, and this is the top, but it makes the needles off the paper.
Okay. Yes, go ahead.
This journal has band-aids on it.
Oh, cool. Well, that's Annie's good. Here's some of the animals that are in the story, and you guys can put a little teddy bear. There you go. And Amanda's going to read the story.
Hey, Emmy.
And this story is called, get it, Tantrum That Saved the World. Okay. Is this on? Did I just shut it off?
Now
I'm on? Okay. So I just shut it off. All right. Bing bong. Sophia was minding her business one day when, quite without warning, a bear came to stay.
Who has a bear?
Who has a teddy bear? Who has a polar bear?
He lived on had ceased to exist.
Wait, I don't have one.
He hoped that Sophia would kindly assist. That means to help.
Wait, there's not enough of them for each of them.
It's okay. We can share. Startled and flustered, Sophia said, no. But the bear came right in.
Bing, nowhere to go. Bing bong.
Where's that bear gonna go?
Where should he go? Where did he come from?
Can you see that? More out-of-towners arrived needing aid, asking if it was all right that they stayed.
The land come and our seas and our flooded our land. Lots of flood, like water coming in from nowhere.
The kids ran right in. They were quite out of hand. Sophia attempted to turn them away.
So, we've got to go. Nowhere else to go. Nowhere else to go.
Wait,
that's
all there's no way to go. Human stuff.
I'm pretty sure you are all human stuffies, aren't you? Are you a human stuffy?
I am.
Oh, you're not a stuffy. Surprising arrivals showed up all day long.
Bing bong, bing bong,
bing bing bong,
who's bing bong?
Oh my gosh, everyone's ringing my doorbell. A sad swarm of bees had not one idea if spring had just come or fall was quite near. A pale pink flamingo, hungry and weak, bugged a sea turtle whose outlook was bleak. Both were upset that the sights of their nests were being disrupted by unwanted guests. Farmers whose farmland was withered and dry griped with the seaman who couldn't get by. Where had the fish gone? Where was the rain? They wanted to work more, not sit and complain. Large Bengal tiger just chuffed with dismay. Everyone wisely stayed out of his way.
Tiger.
They all turned to face her with hope in their eyes, expecting Sophia to halt their demise. I'm just a kid. What can I do?
Someone must help us. If you knew.
It's new.
It's now up to you.
Sophia, by this time, felt nothing but stress. Her day was disrupted, her house was a mess. She had no idea how she ought to begin to help them all out of the bind they were in. Unable to put up a front anymore, she went to her bedroom and slammed the door.
You ever slam the door in your bedroom?
What's it sound like?
It's a tantrum. It's a tantrum. Yeah.
That's the sound of my
Yeah. Oh, okay.
Perfect. Okay. So she's hiding in her room now. Exactly, yeah. Hiding and fretting, she couldn't think why these folks were resolved to gray up her blue sky. She wanted to scream and to act uncontrolled, but tantrums were pointless. That's what she'd been told. Still, it wasn't Sophia's fault they were in strife. She'd tell them politely to get out of her life. But what she saw next brought Sophia up short. They weren't here to spite her. They needed support.
Yeah, there's like raising your hand at school. You need support too sometimes.
Mm-hmm. What are they doing?
Painting. Wait, doing protest signs.
Yes, show me what you guys made last week.
Oh, excellent.
So you're doing this.
Yeah.
Awesome. All of a sudden, the girl understood. Goodwill costs nothing and does nothing but good. Now that she'd realized compassion was key, Sophia would call on the powers that be. Let's go, said Sophia. Next stop, City Hall. The grown-ups would sort this mess once and for all.
Okay, it's just up to you guys now.
My grown-ups. Protect what you love.
You guys have to sort it.
Yeah, sort it out. I need an appointment regarding this fauna who've noticed our planet is becoming a sauna. Does anybody know what a sauna is?
No.
Yeah. So bring us the top dog, the biggest big cheese, to solve all of our problems and put us at ease. They said...
You'll have to take a number and wait.
Hello.
If you please. So what did they do?
Wait.
Mm-hmm. You're waiting with your mom and dad.
Waiting. Yeah. Sophia attempted to move things along. The fact we've been waiting so long is quite wrong. This tiger's hungrier by the minute. This pink flamingo's reached her limit. This polar bear is far too warm. These bees can hardly form a swarm. Someone must help them. Why not you?
We are just as upset as you, but come on, adults.
We've got things to do.
They think are more important.
Mm-hmm. Sophia felt beaten and quite disrespected. She never imagined that she'd be rejected. Again, she felt feelings of rage multiply, but squashed them back down and started to cry. Mm-hmm. Her friends, also glum, gathered round in support. They all shared their stories to make the wait short. Sophia soon saw how each tale was connected, that everyone loses when one part's neglected. How would she feel if her land were depleted? Her food disappeared, her home overheated, and what was to say that she wouldn't be next? She'd already noticed weird weather effects. Weather, guys. How could their leaders command them to wait? If they dilly-dallied, would it be too late? No. Sophia thought deeply and then made her choice. She had to give those who'd been silenced a voice. I want to do something about climate change. Sophia stepped forward.
This is not the Earth, and that's part of mine.
Yes.
Mine too!
Yes. Sophia stepped forward, ignoring the line. She spelled out the science and held up her sign. When someone else suffers, the whole world's affected. The Earth is our home. We have to protect it. Despite her sound logic, she still was deflected.
You're just a kid. We're fixing all the problems. We're still in debt. We've done all we can. Don't you understand? If you've got something you need to say, send a form and we'll file it away.
Oh, they're going to file it away? That doesn't sound like they're going to help. Do you think they're going to help?
No.
I don't think so. Pushed to the limit, Sophia saw red. She felt disregarded and mocked and misled. She did understand what this was about. It was her future they planned to sell out. Sophia's strong feelings smoldered once more, and this time they'd gotten too big to ignore. Raging with purpose, her banner unfurled, she kicked off a tantrum to save the whole world! Action now! Oh my goodness. You see what's happening? It's spreading everywhere, isn't it? Yeah?
Yeah.
It rumbled down streets into towns of all lands. It echoed in forests, on glaciers and sands. People and creatures alike felt its force. They ditched their distractions and looked for the source. There were Sophia and friends holding court, telling the people to lend their support. Cooperative action could turn this high tide. They had strength in numbers and right on their side. Oh, goodness. Step one was to stop using oil, gas, and coal. Step two was to educate every last soul on practical things they could do every day to have an effect in a positive way. They told their officials inside City Hall to pass laws with foresight to better them all. They all told more people who told more folks still. That's a hard one. They won hearts with kindness and minds with goodwill and so on until everyone was doing the hard work that had to be done. Do you guys see this? What happened? One person told some people and then what? They told more? And more.
They mean business. All right. Thank you, Amanda and Terry Lynn and our kids for that very important message. Every week here at First Unitarian, we take up an offering in support of our values. Half of the loose currency in the offering plate goes to a cause with a local presence that resonates with UU principles. If you're on YouTube, you may choose to donate directly to the organization online. Our Share the Plate recipient for September is Planned Parenthood, a nonprofit healthcare provider offering a wide range of patient services for sexual and reproductive health. We encourage you to learn more about Planned Parenthood by visiting plannedparenthood.org. And I invite you to give with a generous heart as we hear a gift of music. I think we have a little contemporary folk coming here into First Unitarian.
Yeah. see through me. I spent 4 years prostrate to the higher mind. Got my paper and I was free. I went to the doctor. I went to the mountains. I looked to the children. I drank from the fountains. And there's more than one answer to these questions, pointing me in a crooked line. And the less I seek my source for some definitive, closer I am to find. Closer I am.
Right, music teacher showing us how to rock. We come to a time for sharing joys and concerns. If you're online and you want one lifted up, you can put it in the comment area. And I've got several from this week. Lita Magisana is facing some health issues. Let's send her some good healing energy, and Lita welcomes visits and calls. Kim Callahan here shares the wonderful joy of learning from a CT scan that the tumor is stable, not growing. So she's able to wait until winter on a follow-up. So, whew, all very happy for Kim. And Terry Lynn has this update. I'm doing well. The cast comes off on September 29th. You might have noticed she had something on her arm there as she was helping with that story. And after that, she'll be able to have occupational therapy. And she wants to thank everyone for the support. And I want to share the joy that Judy Unger has moved from our longtime summer music director to a new position with the church now of being our interim music director, helping to pull together a revitalized contemporary music group as well as continuing to bring us wonderful guests. So good to have you, Judy. And one other happy bit of news on our staffing, Sarah Schweitzer is our new child care coordinator, and we're very pleased to have her in that role. Yeah. Okay, as we hold in care everyone who knows both joy and sorrow, I invite you to join me in a centering song. This is number 402, From You I Receive. This music, let us continue in a mood of meditation. or prayer. After a pastoral introduction, we'll observe a time of silence together, which will end when I ring the bell. During the quiet, you can meditate, pray, send out good energy for all of those who are healing, or whatever moves you. But first, as we take a deep breath, I share with you this prayer for the children by Gary Kowalski. We pray for the children, for the voiceless, for the innocent, for the vulnerable, for the least powerful among us, and those most in need of our protection. We pray for the children who depend on adults to make their world safe, to create networks of care and learning, and to provide the schools and doctors and counselors and teachers that support them in their growth. We pray for the children who do not understand partisan politics, who are not registered to vote, who are not interested in debating points, but who have a very deep interest in clean air and pure water and a world without war. We pray for the children who trust their elders to exercise wisdom, to act responsibly, but who are so often disappointed and betrayed in that trust. We pray for the children who are satisfied with so little, a warm blanket, a roof overhead, a good pair of sneakers, but who often lack even the barest of necessities. We pray for the children, for the ones on honor rolls and the ones on drugs, for the well-adjusted and those who have been battered and traumatized by life. We pray for the children, for those tormented by bullies at school, and for the bullies themselves, tormented by demons we cannot even imagine. We pray for the children, for girls and boys and children who see far too much sex and violence on TV and are assaulted and seduced with unhealthy images of femininity and masculinity. We pray for the children who remind us of all that is tender and playful in ourselves and of our own capacity for laughter and for love. We pray for the children who contain all the promise of generations to come and all the possibilities of tomorrow. Help us, we pray, to be the guardians and advocates of all children everywhere, with eyes to see that all are children of God. Amen. Now a silent time for your own inward reflection. Our Director of Lifespan Religious Education, Christina Strong, will get us started on a series of reflections on teaching and learning as a ministry of this congregation.
Good morning. So the title of our service today is Learning Odyssey, And now we will have four people come forward to share their teaching odysseys. And as I'm sure you all know, if you've had experience teaching one person or many, those are not opposite things. As we teach, we are learning. And so far our service has focused on our children and the things that they need from our community. And we've invited our teachers to share the ways that working with our children has enriched their lives. The three teachers that I've invited who work with our children and youth have all been doing this work here with your community much longer than I've been here. I consider them all to be spiritually mature Unitarian Universalists, and I think that teaching others about this faith and this tradition is a really key part to deepening one's own spirituality and becoming spiritually mature within this faith. I know for me, the amount of sort of personal growth that I've experienced since working with your community in this capacity is far beyond what I would have even expected. And so I will let our teachers share with you their experiences here. And first I invite Shari Connor, who has worked for 10 years with our elementary children.
Good morning. You know that line, it takes a village to raise a child? I had it in my first draft. I took it out. Anyway, my name is Shari Connor, and I'm here to tell you about my experience as a religious education teacher here at First U. I first started attending church here in 2011 and got involved with the RE program not long after that, and I became a member in 2014. I want to get to the core of why I'm an RE teacher, or to get to the core of that, I have to answer the question, why I'm a UU. And the answer to the question of why is community. We are bound together by our shared search for spiritual growth, guided by our seven principles. Our children are part of this community, and I feel it is incumbent upon me, the RE teacher, and the community as a whole to support them along their own unique spiritual path. Our RE program offers age-appropriate education that fosters the values of our community. By teaching our children, I, by extension, am impacting the future of the greater community in which we live, and maybe even the world, because I do believe our children will grow up to do great things. In a way, teaching forges life-shaping relationships that I believe make a difference in these children's paths, in their lives. By introducing them to our unique UU worldview and inspiring them to think from the perspective of our seven principles, we are giving them a roadmap to help them navigate through the obstacles that life will throw in their path. I find that each lesson is something new and offers me ways in which to put my creativity to work. And as the kids and I sit around the table in our classroom or take a walk outside to learn about our connection to nature, I learn from them too. They offer a type of unvarnished wisdom that only children have, and they make me smile. And through the years I've taught our youngsters, I've grown close to them, and I derive great joy from watching them grow and thrive, and I'm grateful for the opportunity to profoundly impact their lives.
Sing along.
Together we share.
All right, our next speaker was unable to join us in person today, so we have her by video. This is Jody Petro. She's been teaching for our elementary RE for 7 years and is taking a break this year. Jody's also a teacher in her every weekday life. She teaches middle school English.
Hi, I'm Jody Petro. I've been teaching RE for 6 or 7 years. I've been doing it, I guess, mostly about twice a month. They asked me to talk about why I did it, what I liked about it. I started when my kids were in church, and it were in the elementary RE program, which they haven't been for a couple of years. And I liked feeling like I was contributing to the church, like the act of service. I appreciated that, feeling like it was something I could do to give back. But, you know, I kept doing it after my kids were gone. And some of that is I really like getting to know the kids in our program. We have really cool, creative, interesting kids. I don't know if you ever look up front when they do story time, but our kids are cool. I had one, like, just in the past year, I had one kid who was like in first or second grade who came in and was like determined to design a board game. And it was complex and cool, and everybody in the whole group got into it. And so it became like this really cool thing we did. And it was totally motivated by this young child who was just very creative and motivated and interesting. Another time we watched it, we were talking about how some countries don't have access to clean water. And we watched a video about a program that was drilling for clean water. And one of the kids, again, like, you know, a young kid, like I can't remember what grade he was in, but he was a young elementary schooler, was asking me all these questions about how the drill worked and how they did. And I was like, it was just so cool to watch a kid that age be that interested in that kind of thing. And I think that's what a lot of our kids are like. They're really cool, interesting kids, and it's cool to get to know them. And I also really enjoyed getting to know their parents, like their families, the young families in the church. Because I think sometimes, when you're a young family, sometimes it's hard because your kids dominate so much of your life to be a part of a lot of things. And so it was a cool way to meet people in that part of our community. So that's what I liked.
From you I received, to you I give. Together we share, but from this we live.
All right, and our next speaker is Ben Stallings, who works with our teenagers as a YRUU advisor and also sometimes on Sunday mornings.
Good morning. As some of you know, I was raised Unitarian at All Souls Church in Tulsa. And what really kept me in the faith was attending YRUU as a teenager. I had the feeling that what we did in the youth room was in some ways a better expression of our values and principles than what happened in the sanctuary. And a big part of that was the adult volunteers who helped out with the group. They were able to give us the structure and advice when we needed it, but also give us the freedom to make our own rules and make our own mistakes to learn and grow as individuals. And I'm still in touch with many of them 30-some years later. And as soon as I was old enough to volunteer myself, as an adult with the youth group, I started doing that. And that's been almost 23 years ago now. And as Christina said, I'm still working with the youth group now. And the reason why is pretty simple. As Jody said, we have really great kids. Even those of you who have teenagers who may cause you some trouble at home, when they're in the social hall with us on Wednesday nights, they are some of the most insightful and compassionate Unitarians that I have ever met. And so while it may be true that Catholics raise the most Unitarians, we raise the best ones here ourselves. And they're becoming the people, right now, they are becoming the people that they're gonna be for the rest of their lives. And it's, you know, I wouldn't wanna miss it. And I don't want to miss it, and I don't plan to. But burnout is a real thing that you know, it's a real danger. And when we're short on volunteers, we can't do a lot of the things that we would like to do, such as lock-ins and field trips and, you know, activities like ropes courses and, you know, things that could really bond the group together in a way that, you know, sitting in a circle in the social hall cannot do. So I hope that if any of you know anyone who might be interested in working with this dynamic group of teenagers, that you'll encourage them in our direction. Thank you.
As you can see, we've been blessed with some wonderful teachers, and we'd love to have more teachers and advisors. And we need to not forget the adults, right? We believe here in growing all throughout our lives. I'm very excited that we have a team just in the last few months that's come together for adult religious education that is planning wonderful things this fall. And we're going to hear from one of those folks right now, Neva Cousine, who's been one of our leaders with small group ministry for several years. Neva.
Hello. My name is Neva Cousine, and I was asked to talk to you today about my experiences with adult religious education. I believe that whoever you are teaching or educating is less about the age of the participants or the topic, and more about what the teacher, group leader, or facilitator brings to the group and understands the needs of the students. My first experience with adult education at First Unitarian was with the Women's Religious Study Group. This was probably over 15 years ago. There were different leaders of the group, and we would read about and discuss world religions. But more than learning about religion, we also learned about each other. And that's why adult education is so important to me. Adults want to be able to share their lives and experiences. And it is interesting to see how our lives intersect and differ. Thank you. In facilitating an adult group, there are ideas about education that have to be rethought. There are no right or wrong answers, and no right or wrong way of facilitating. You are a leader, and you want to help lead the group to learn what they want to learn. But there are different ways to do this, and the group will quickly pick up your sincere care for them and for learning and help the group learn. So many times, the group will assist the leader. Here's a quote from the Tao that I think is so important. When I am aware of my need to be seen and to be respected, I know that I am lost, and I am often lost. But when I see only the other person with clarity and compassion, we are both on the path again. So adult religious education is a chance to interact and learn with others on a person-to-person basis. I believe it is also a happy thing for a group to become friends. The group I led last fall had sincere care for each other, and we would go out for coffee and laugh all the way through it. There's two of them back there. Hi. If you would like to become a facilitator, please let Christina know. And we can support you and provide information so you can enjoy facilitating. And you can facilitate with someone with more experience. It is more about listening sincerely to others than anything else. You will gain more than you give. It's a wonderful, wonderful thing to do. Thank you so much.
All right, so at this time, I would like to invite all of our 2022 and 2023 religious education leaders to come up, both children's and youth and adults. And this year in the preschool room, we have Sarah Schweitzer, our new childcare coordinator. And for our elementary RE teachers, we have Amanda Burton and Sherry Connor and Donna Neff, as she is available. And Roman Noriega is our dependable assistant in there on a regular basis. And then for our Sunday morning teen class, we have Ryan Cook and Bethany Cook, and we would love to have some more people join us to work with our teens on Sunday mornings. For Why Are You You, we have Ryan again, Bethany, if she's available, and we have Ben Stallings and his wife, Jessie Stallings. A couple of you have indicated an interest in learning more about what we do on Wednesday nights, and I'll be reaching out to you this week. And then we are also going to have some advisors from Second Unitarian who are joining us for the first time. And then, Shari, do you want to introduce our adult RE?
Yes, and I'd love to invite forward also our adult RE leaders. So Neva and Mike, come on up. Shari, I think you were already called up, so come on up. And I know we have folks who help with a number of other groups. If you lead a book group, if you lead morning meditations, if you lead any group that is for adults in this congregation that helps with spiritual growth, I invite you to come on forward.
Also, we know that some of you are participating from home, and this is for you too. And if you're comfortable doing so, please participate verbally along with those in the sanctuary. Reverend Woodbury and I will invite the teachers, children, youth, and congregation to participate in a covenant. And our children talk today about a covenant. As we do so, we will let each group know when you may affirm your commitment by saying, "We will."
All right.
Good job. Good practice round.
That was a good practice. Okay, so teachers, advisors, and facilitators. Let me get through it all before you say, "We will." Do you covenant together to help and support one another and to work together cooperatively in the best interests of all the participants in our religious education programs? Will you honor the trust given to you by our children and youth and their parents? Will you honor the spark of learning that continues to shine in adult learners too? Will you treasure all of these relationships with our RE staff and volunteers, with children and youth we teach and learn from, with their families, and with adult participants as well? If you will, you may say, "We will."
We will. All right, children and youth, this is your part. Make sure you listen because you want to know what you're agreeing to. All right, children and youth, where are you? Can you wave your hands around? Sometimes it's hard to tell. All right. Will you covenant together, make a promise, to make new friends and to treat each other with kindness and respect? Will you promise to learn about Unitarian Universalism and to share what you've learned with your parents? Will you help build a loving and caring community here at First Unitarian Church? If you can agree to that, say, "We will."
We will. We will.
Thank you.
All right, now everyone in the congregation who's not already standing, I invite you to rise if you're able to do so, or you can participate from your seat. Members and friends of First UU, will you covenant together to provide an atmosphere of support and challenge for these teachers, advisors, and facilitators, and for the children, youth, and adults in our programs? Will you promise to learn about our faith and continue to grow along with them? Will you promise to be partners to our teachers in the sacred task of nurturing the development of our children? If so, you may say, "We will."
We will.
It is our honor to serve you and journey with you on this path of learning and development. We promise to be there for you and to work with you as together we support the growth of love and understanding, freedom, and spiritual connection in children, youth, and adults. This we will do. All Right. Thank you all. You can go back to your seats now, and I invite you to remain standing if you'd like for our closing song. And yeah, let's give a round of applause for these teachers. And our closing hymn is number 301 in the gray hymnal, Touch the Earth, Reach the Sky. Isn't it wonderful to be part of an intergenerational community? I love it. Let us continue to touch the earth and reach the sky and laugh and cry. Let us continue to ask the reasons why all throughout our lives and embrace together the ministry of teaching and learning in this church. Amen.
Please sing along this last song if you know it. I know some of you know it, so please. And and I just want to make a quick plug. There will be a new contemporary group forming. We'll perform the last or the fourth Sunday of every month. I can't talk, but I can play. Anyway, if you're interested, please see me after church.
You who are on the run must have a code that you can live by and so become yourself, because the past is just a goodbye. Teach your children well, their father's hell did slowly go by, and feed them on your dreams, the one they pick, the one you'll know by. Don't you ever ask them why, if they told you, you would cry, so just look at them and sigh, and know they love. And you of the tender years can't know the fears that your elders grew by. And so please help them with your youth. They seek the truth before they can die and teach your parents well. Their children's hell will slowly go by and feed them on your dreams. The one they pick, the one you'll know by. Don't you ever ask them why. If they told you, you would cry. So just look at them inside. And know they love.